All right, folks, I think we're all good now. Shalom, everyone. Shalom.
Shalom.
Everyone still keeping the commandments?
Yep.
Shalom.
Still keeping the commandments.
You're still keeping the commandments?
Yep.
And statutes and the laws and the ordinances of the Most High?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, you should be sealed. You should be sealed in this great tribulation. Hallelujah. All right.
Yeah.
All right. So let's pray and we're going to get started immediately. And it can be interactive tonight, but we want to continue our teaching. We've been talking about eschatological events and end time. And if ever there's a time to explore, to investigate the scriptures, to study as a workman that needed not to be ashamed, it is now. The scripture is open. And so we must study the volume of the book. Yahushua said, I come in the volume of the book. And so tonight we're going to begin to just explore and go deeper into eschatological, or what we call apocalyptic eschatological events, and see where Israel, where do you fit in at? And so we're going to talk about some groundbreaking things tonight, some things that you may have never heard, but we're going to search the scripture diligently, line upon line, precept upon precept, here little, there little, as we begin to explore not only the Tanakh, but also the Brit Hadashah tonight. And so let's pray. Father, we're grateful and thankful that we are a part of the land of the living, in which a day in which the prophets spake of, a day in which the Mashiach saw, a day in which Ezekiel and Daniel and all our forefathers who stood in the position, in the posture of the Navi or the Navim or the prophets, we get a chance as believers, as descendants of Yaqub, as descendants of Isaac, as descendants of Abraham, we get a chance to see what Daniel and what Ezekiel and what other prophets spake of. And so our Father, I pray that we will have our ear to your mouth, that we will hear what you are saying. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Ruach is saying. Ruach, I pray that you will speak. I pray that you would eliminate the spirit of error, and I pray you release the spirit of accuracy, that we will speak and only say what we hear you speak and say. I pray for your word, your will, and your wisdom will be manifested, that you will open up the ears and the spirit and the ruach of our understanding, that we may understand that we might not be in a position where we're ever learning but never coming into the knowledge of the truth. I pray that in this season, a season where on every side, there is calamity, there is destruction, there is pandemics, there is epidemic, things are in epidemic proportions, there is government takeover, there is executive orders, there is FEMA camps, there is a slew of things that's going on. But for the believer, for the awakened Israelite, we know these things are going to come. You do nothing in the earth until you first reveal it unto them that fear you. So Father Yah, tonight we thank you that we stand in the posture, we stand in the position, knowing that we have already seen the end from the beginning. This we pray in the name of Yahushua HaMashiach. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, people. So we're going to ask each of you mute. I'm going to attempt. I'm going to try my best to mute everyone, but it is very tedious. It is a rigorous arduous process. Thank you. And I think it makes for a lot of impediments during the study. So if you do have a question tonight, raise your hand. If I do not see your hand, if you unmute yourself, but please afterwards, please mute yourself again so that we can have some continuity and we can flow tonight. All right. And so some people do not learn or they cannot process the information or metabolize the information, or even disseminate the information when there is a lot of competition for their attention. And certainly when your phone is on mute and we can hear all the distractions in the background, again, those impediments. I can do that, Ro. I'm not, okay, thank you, Ro. Ro said, if I open up the participants, let me read that again. If I open up the participants.
Hit participants. You see participants down there where it says 16. Click that. It's going to show you everybody's face and name and all that. You should be able to see a button that says mute all.
Excellent. You are a genius. Great. Absolutely. Thank you. That helps tremendously. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. All right, Ms. Bahad, we'll start tonight. As you all know, we've been preparing for such a time as this as an assembly. We've been preparing those who are in our sphere of influence. With spiritual renewal comes social, economic, and survival strategies. And if we have not prepared you, not only spiritually, there's a number of people who are preparing, people who are under their care, under their auspices. They are preparing them spiritually. But along with spiritual renewal or spiritual awakening, it comes social and economic and survival strategies. And that's where we get the term spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare is a term strategeo. Strategeo is where we get the word strategize from, or strategy from, or stratagem from. And so the word warfare means strategy. And so Yah has given us a strategy. We just have to extrapolate it out of his Tanakh, out of the Brit Hadashah, out of the words of the Messiah, out of the words of the prophets, out of the words of Torah. And so if we begin to examine Torah, the prophets, the Ketuvim, the writings, as well as the Brit Hadashah and the eschatological writings, the end time writings of the prophets, we begin to see our plan and our strategy. There's no strategy beyond or outside of the strategy in which the Most High has given us. He is an Elohim, a pattern. And so tonight, hopefully we'll get to the point where you understand the patterns of the Most High. The scripture says that he made his ways known unto Moses, but his actions unto the people. And so it's when you begin to really understand the law and understand his ordinances and his commands and his feast days and the Moeds, when we fully understand those in its proper context, we begin to see there's a pattern that the Most High have. And so that's why he does nothing in the earth until we first reveal it unto them that fear him. So when we walk in the commandments of Yahuwah, when we walk in the appointed times, I'm going to show you that tonight. What do the appointed times have to do with this COVID-19 pandemic? What do we have to do with FEMA camps? What do I have to do with martial law? What do I have to do with all these things that have people up in arms about? It has everything to do with it. Because if we follow the patterns of the Most High, again, we know the end from the beginning, and there's nothing that has been done that won't be done again, according to the scriptures. So everything is strategic. That's the word strategic again. Warfare. Part of warfare is having a strategy against the foes. And if we're going to survive in the end times, when tribulation and the great tribulation hit, we have to follow the prescribed strategies or warfare tactics that the Most High have given us. And so we know that the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, but they're mighty through Yah to the pulling down of every stronghold. And so tonight we're going to talk about how do we, as we begin to continue to talk about the seals, and we talk about the trumpets, and we talk about the bowls, and we talk about all of these eschatological events, I want you to begin to see the strategy of the Most High weave into it, because there is a pattern. So when we talk about the laws, I think we just use it in a very bland and a very basic, in its basic definition. We use laws in terms of, this is instructions that the Most High has given us. This is the precepts he has given us. But when we fully begin to see the laws as they are, a law is a systematic way in which something functions or operates. Again, it's a systematic way in which something functions or operates. So Yah operates in a systematic way. And he wants us to operate in a systematic way. Why? Because anything that operates in a systematic way, it typically it's somewhat predictable because it's a systematic way. So because Yah operates in a systematic way, we can trust him. He changeth not, right? He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. There is consistency with Yah. And so if we study Yah, we study his word, we study his law, he began to reveal himself unto us, and we can begin to follow his character, follow his patterns, following his appointed times or his moeds, right? Moedims. And so we'll talk about that and tie that into Revelation tonight. Certainly that's the objective tonight, Mishpaha. All right, so before we do that, we have to get ready, folks. And hopefully if you're not ready, that you are in the process of getting ready. But by now, we have prepared you for such. You all know we have had our meetings. We have prepared our assembly. We're continuing to prepare them because, again, with spiritual renewal comes social and economic as well as survival strategies. And so we have to teach you how to survive. And all that come out of the scriptures itself. So notice we are living in a day, of course, where we call global coup d'etat. Global coup d'etat deals with a takeover. And so notice that there's a number of CEOs are stepping down. Notice that people of major companies are just resigning. Notice that even there's a shift in even terms of the political structure as well, right? But look, that's why, folks, many of us don't vote. I vote in terms of local elections, but not in terms of federal. And to each his own, right? You should be persuaded in your own mind. But politics, we get the term politics. We get, in fact, I think it's Colossians that says we have our citizenship is in the Shamahim or in heaven. So the word politics is polituma or polituma. So the word citizen there is polituma, where you get the word politics. And scripture says our citizenship is in the Shamahim. Our citizenship is in heaven. So we get our agenda from the heavens. So as an awakened Hebrew messianic believer, we don't follow, we don't watch the elephant, we don't watch the donkey, we watch the lamb of Yah that was slain for the remission of our sin. And so we don't look to the left, we don't look to the right, folks. We're not left wing, we're not right wing, we're under his wings, right? So we dwell under his wings. So we know that there's a lot of things going on, folks. There is, of course, predictive programming. There is, you know, pandemonium among people. We're dealing with the pandemic disease in order to drive certain agendas. We have sporting events and concert events that are shutting down. There's global panic mode. Everybody's in panic mode, right? We got shut down of grocery stores, shut down of public places. Transportation is being taken over. Yesterday, I gave many of you during our private meeting, we went over some executive orders. Executive orders feed right into the hands of giving this power to the Antichrist. Giving it over. Folks, we are living, folks, in prophetic biblical time. We're living in. So notice there's population control. While we're dealing with curfews. Domestic airlines are being grounded. There's international borders are being closed. There's restrictions on healthcare. People can't get their medicine, et cetera. Folks, if this is not a wake-up call, awake thou the slumber. What I can't understand is that many Christians who see that we are in a time, signs of the time, and many of them still won't follow the commandments. That's why the scripture says that their conscience is seared with a hot iron. Which means no matter what you say to certain folks, no matter what, how many scripture you give them, they're not going to change because they've been given over to a reprobated mind. They'd rather believe a lie than the truth. That's why Christianity, folks, is a heck of a drug because it impacts your mental processes. It impacts your thinking faculties. It don't allow you to think beyond and listen to the Ruach. And so that's the stronghold that many Christians say they got the Ruach. But that's that stronghold. That's holding them strong. And that's why the Mashiach repeatedly dealt with the Essenes, scribes, and Pharisees, and the religious figures of the day. And the number one thing he dealt with was their tradition, because tradition is an impediment. Tradition of men, or the dogma of men, never get dogma confused with nomos. Nomos is the law of Moses. Dogma is the law of man, or the ordinances of man. And so the ordinances or the laws or the traditions of men, what did the Mashiach say? Is made the truth of none effect. Because it's always going to be an impediment, it's going to be diametrically opposed to the word of the Most High. All right. So we know there's a lot going on, but folks, it's all setting up for one new world order, whether we're talking about the UN, whether we're talking about the Commission of Global Governance, whether we're talking about the global tax initiative, it's all feeding towards what we've been talking about before, right? Because we've got a broader audience. I won't go specifically in detail, but you all know that we've been preparing for this. And I think for the most part, I think we are prepared attitudinally more so than any other. So we got to be prepared attitudinally. If not, we're going to be devoured by the beasts. All right. So we're going to continue our teaching tonight. Last week, we had the privilege and the honor to talk about the seven trumpets. So we talked about the seven trumpets. We went in detail talking about the plagues. We dealt with, I think we stopped at the fifth one. And I don't think we really explored the six and the seven. So we already know the signs of the times. We already know when we read Revelation, we read Daniel in sequential and chronological order, we already know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. One of the things that I want to caution you all, and I don't think anyone on here, anyone in our assembly, thinking that the Mashiach is coming back soon. He's not coming back, all right? Now we need to, and we know that our redemption draws nigh during the signs of the time, but there are certain eschatological events that must occur before the Mashiach comes back. So we'll deal with that, but do we know when the Mashiach is coming back? Do we know what season he's coming back? Anybody, can unmute yourself?
Yes.
We do.
Yom Teruah.
He's coming back doing Yom Teruah. How do we explain that to Christians and others? Because they're immediately going to go to a scripture that says, no man knows the day nor the hour.
We can show them the times and how in the Bible.
Right, absolutely. So we know that there is a pattern, a point in time. Everything that the Most High, we know the end from where? From the beginning. So we're going to show you tonight how even Abraham followed the appointed times of the Most High. Wait a minute. I thought that the appointed time was given to Moshe. Abraham lived before Moshe. How can you say that he followed the appointed time? I'm going to show you that in the scriptures tonight. Because just because it wasn't written down doesn't mean that Yah hasn't always had appointed times. He has always had appointed times. And for those who know, so that's why Daniel chapter 7, verse 25 said, this is an all-out war against the Most High. And to wear out what? The saints of the Most High by changing what? Seasons and the appointed times of the Most High. Because if somehow we can get you discombobulated and get you all out of sequence with the appointed times of the Most High, what's going to happen? You're going to miss his appoint. You're going to miss what he's doing. So how do we know what he's doing? For the Israelite, for those who are awakened and those who have cleaved to Israel, we know what to do. That's why David, see, everything is a type and shadow. David surrounded himself with the sons of Issachar. And the scripture says, the sons of Issachar knew the times and they knew what they should do. Let me say that again. The sons of Issachar, they knew the times and they knew what they should do. So tonight, that's what we want over the Israelite believer, the messianic believer who guard the commandments, laws, and statutes. That's why it's important for any believer to say that the feasts are null and void, that the feasts are irrelevant, that the feast carries no weight, that the feast is insignificant, is a person who's out of step and they are out of tune, not only with the scriptures, but the Most High, because you have disregarded his times. And that's why we read in Colossians chapter 2, let no man judge you concerning the what? Concerning the Sabbaths, concerning the new moons and the festivals, the feasts. Why? Because they are a shadow of what's to come. We know what's to come when we follow Pesach, Feast of the Unleavened, Feast First Fruit, Shavuot, or Pentecost, Yom Teruah, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot, or Feast of the Tabernacle. If we just follow it, we know exactly what season the Most High or the Mashiach is coming back. Absolutely, positively, unequivocally, without question, without doubt, irrevocably, we know when he's coming back. We don't know the day or the hour, but let's look at that in Hebrew. The feast that's called the Feast of No Man Know the Day or the Hour is the Feast of Yom Teruah. We blow trumpets when? During Yom Teruah. Paul said in 1 Thessalonians, this would be a sound, this would be a shout with the trump of the Most High. So there's going to be a trumpet. We see the trumpets blowing in Revelation. There's trumpets blowing in 2 Chronicles, where we find that King David is now coronating Solomon to be next in line as kingship. Everything points to the Mashiach. So we do know, you do have an advantage. That's why Shaul said in Galatians chapter 3, verse 1, what advantage do the Israelite have? And he said, much in every way. Why? Is our blood different from anyone? No, it's because it's not about nationality, right? It's not about color. But he has given our ancestors the ordinances. So we have an advantage over everybody else. When everybody else is tripping out, everybody else is freaking out, everybody else is in panic mode, we cool, calm, and collective. Because we know this is just a test of the emergency broadcasting system. It's just a test, because we are secured by the appointed Moeds or the Moedims. We know the times and what we should do and when we should do it. So tonight we're just going to explore that a little deeper so that you can have a working definition of times itself and know the seasons in which we're in. Hallelujah. All righty then. All right. Probably should have already been set. All right, folks, so we'll begin. Can everyone hear me tonight?
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
All right. Hallelujah.
I'm gonna try to get it rather this, sometimes when we post this on social media, we find a little gray mark. So I'm trying to eliminate that. All right, folks, so last week we talked about the trumpets and the trumpets being open. Tonight we're going to dig a little deeper and we're going to actually go backwards. So in sequential order or in chronological order, we find that there are first the seal.
If you talk and we can't hear you.
We still can't hear you, Dr. Howard.
Oh, he should be able to come back in. You're muted, Dr. Howard, just so you know.
All right, Ms. Baha. All right, I think I did something. Can you all see me?
No. Now we can. Yes.
Okay. All right, let's try this again. Let's try this again. Okay. So we're going to start Revelation chapter 5 tonight. Revelation chapter 5, starting at verse 1. Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and a seal and sealed with seven seals. Now the seals aren't being opened yet, folks, but the seals are going to be open. But before we do that, let's see.
Go sit down.
Write these.
Okay.
Let's see who can begin to understand these seals as the seals are being opened. All right, as the seals are being opened. Let's look at this a little deeper as we go here. So it says, verse 2, and I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll. I want you to pay attention. Verse 3, but no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside. We need to stop there, because not even the Mashiach. And it goes on to say that the Mashiach is the one who's going to read it. But at this time, not even the Mashiach. Verse 4, and I wept, because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or to look inside. Then one of the elders said unto me, do not weep. See or look, the lion of the tribe of who? Of Yehuda, the root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll in the seven seals. So notice that most of the time we tend to look over this verse here. Most people go right into the seals and they begin to open up the seals. But I want you to begin to pay attention to this and think critically, right? Because I think this is a critical timepiece in terms of what happened. Let's look at verse 2 again. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, who is worthy to break the seal and open the scroll? But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the seal or even look inside it. Triumphant, he is able to open the scroll in its seven seals. No one in the heaven or on earth or under the earth, that's pretty much everywhere. Right? Actually not. Because when you begin to look at this critical timepiece and begin to look at line upon line and precept upon precept, there are some things that I think we tend to overlook when it comes to this. So that's why when you understand this, people believe that John is really seeing heaven at a time when he was in the spirit. So keep in mind, he's in the spirit on the island of Patmos. And I believe personally he was taken back. I'm going to show you why I believe that. I believe that he was taken back in time. And I know it sounds strange, it probably sounds bizarre, but let's look after the ascension of the Mashiach in Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, right? That most people probably have never seen before. Watch this. Acts chapter 3, verse 20. And that he may send the Christ who had been appointed for you, even Yahushua. He must remain in heaven until the time comes for Yah to restore everything as he promised long ago through his holy prophets. Let's get another precept on that. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up unto heaven and saw the glory of Yah and Yahusha, and standing at his right, at the right hand of Yah, standing at the right hand of Yah, right? Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 34 on your screen. Who is he that condemns? The Mashiach, Yahusha, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of Yah and is interceding for us. Let's get some more precept. For Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself now to appear for us in Yah's presence. Watch this. Knowing that he had been in heaven ever since. Why is he not in heaven here when John says, when John was in the spirit? I just read you precepts that he has been in heaven. Post-resurrection, we see the Mashiach in heaven. But why isn't he in heaven at this time? It doesn't, but notice what it doesn't say. It doesn't say below heaven or above earth. It doesn't say below heaven or above earth. So where is Yahusha? He was in the process of coming to the Shamahim. He was in the process of coming to heaven. So what John is being shown, he's being shown this here a time just after Acts chapter 1. Let's do it again. Acts chapter 1. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and the cloud hid him from their sight. What did the cloud do? It hid them from, I believe that John could not see the Mashiach at this time because he was hidden. So one of the things that we don't look at in the scriptures, and I heard people who try to debate me on this, we don't see where it says below the heaven or above the earth. Why? Because the Mashiach is now making his transition into the Shamahim, into the heavens. And we see John himself, John sees it. He sees a glimpse of that. He's taken back in the past and he sees the heaven, he sees the earth and below the earth, but he's caught, it is hidden from him. It is hidden from them. So he wasn't seeing the present or even the future. He was actually seeing the past, and no one was in heaven at the moment who could open the scroll. No one was on earth or below the earth who can do it, who can open the scroll. It was of the Mashiach. Let's begin in Revelation chapter 5. I'll come back to that, right? Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David. He was triumphant. He is able to open the scrolls and the seven seals." Verse 6, "Then I saw the Lamb looking as if he had been what? Slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. And he had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of Yah sent out into all the earth." So notice that the Lamb enters the scene. Yahusha enters the scene. The slain Lamb of the Most High now enters into heaven. But at the time, if you read it before, Yochanan or John did not see this. Because this is the Mashiach. He's in the process of being delivered unto heaven. So that's why Yahusha is seen here having scars. Notice what it says here, being slain on the tree, but now he's seen in heaven. All right, let's continue. Verse 7, "He came and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and open the seals, because you were slain, and with the blood you purchased me, the men for Yah, for every tribe and of every language and people and every nation. Okay. Verse 10, you have made them a kingdom of priests to serve of Yah. You have made them a what? A kingdom of priests. That's why you're a royal priesthood. Right? You're a holy nation. And they will reign on in heaven. They will reign where? On earth. That's why the Mashiach prayed in John chapter 17. Father, I pray that as you and I are one, that they might be one. Don't take them out of this world, but leave them in this world. Just keep them from the evil one. That's why the meek shall inherit the earth. That's why we pray, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, not thy kingdom go, but thy kingdom come, that thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so his kingdom come. And so Yah wants us to reign here on earth. Verse 11, then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. And they encircled the throne and the living creatures of the elders. Verse 12, and a loud voice they say, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing to him who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and they worship. Notice that all heaven and creation declares what he has just completed. He just completed what? Death, the burial, and the resurrection. So notice what the text seemed to show us, though, that Yahusha has truly just come on the seal. Now he's about to break the seals. He's about to break the seal. So we go back to verse 9. We go back to verse 5. Notice it's something we should consider. When it take place? It take place right after the death and the resurrection. Right after the death and the resurrection. That's why we sing a new song unto him. A new song. And so when we look at this, I believe that this take place. And just walk with me tonight. I believe that this takes place during the feast. Everything that we're going to talk about in terms of the seals being open, that's why we're on the heels of Pesach and the Feast of Unleavened, because Yah does nothing in the earth until he first revealed it through his appointed times. We know the end from the beginning. Let me say that again. We know the end from the beginning, all right? So I'm going to show you how this ascension, and we know the ascension take place where? During what feast? First fruit, right? First fruit. That's why he's resurrected. Not during Shavuot, because Shavuot, you have to count the Omer, and that's 49 days, leading up to the 50th day, which is Shavuot, or what in the Greek, Pentecost, as many Christians call it, Pentecost, but we know it to be Shavuot, right? So we see the seals are both actually to be broken just after Yahusha has entered into where? The Shamahim. And so this changed the perspectives in terms of how we see the seals, right? Let's look at the first seal. Let's start breaking the seals down, all right? Revelation chapter 6, verse 1, right? Read! All right. I watched a lamb open the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures saying, and a voice like thunder saying, come. And I looked, and there before me was a white horse. His rider held a bow and was given a crown. And he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. Now, some people, I've heard people read, this is Yahushua. This is the Mashiach. While other people say this is the Antichrist beginning to rule. Now, I've done a lot of study on this. What this is, again, these, whenever you see the seals are things that are happening in the spirit realm. They have not fully manifested on the earth. These are things that are happening in the spirit realm. So when I begin to really study this, I used to teach this a lot during undergraduate school many moons ago. I've been saying for years that this is the spirit of the Antichrist. It's not the Antichrist yet, but it is the spirit of the Antichrist that's now in the world. Let me get a precept on that so you can understand what I'm talking about. But every spirit, 1 John chapter 4, verse 3, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Yahusha, right, is not from Yah. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, even now is already in the world. The Antichrist spirit, even in John's day, was already in the world. Now, I understand that that means there's types of Antichrist have existed. When we look throughout, the history of since the first century, we know there was a number of Antichrists or the spirit of the Antichrist. But what I mean by the spirit of the Antichrist, and as you see it now being released during this first seal being opened, it is now the Antichrist actually being increased at the breaking of the seal. So we have always had the spirit of the Antichrist or Anti-Mashiach have always been around. But now when the seal is broken, it's being increased. It's being proliferated. It's being expanded. Now we're seeing the spirit of the Antichrist like never, ever before. So let's go back, right? Let's deal with the next one. When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, come. It is again. Then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take the peace from the earth, to take shalom from the earth, and to make men slay each other. To him was given a large sword. So we know this is pretty inevitable, right? It deals with war. It deals with chaos, right? It's already been released. And that's why there's wars, have always been wars. But when you look at the seals, when the seals are being opened, folks, now we've seen an increase of that activity. So we know the first seal, we know that the spirit of the anti-Mashiach is going to be increased. The second seal is the seal where there's going to be an increase, folks, in a murder, right? Taking peace from the earth and men slaying one another and killing one another. These seals are being opened. Now, I'm going to show you the progression of these seals. And we're going to begin to ask you a question, whether or not you think those seals have already been opened, or they are being opened now, or they're going to be opened in the future. Let's continue. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard a third living creature say, come. Right? That word come has deep, deep connotations. Hopefully I'll get to it when we go on, because you're going to see a pattern with come. I look, and there before he was a black horse. Its rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. Then I heard what sounded like a voice among the four creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a day's wages and three quarts of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil in the wine. So we know when you really look at the third seal, it's talking about famine. It's talking about economic disaster. It's talking about poor economic conditions on the earth. And so many people, they'll argue with this as well, but we see this is a time where there's going to be an increase over time of poverty and poor, or poverty and famine, and people having lack, and they are insolvent when it comes to fiscally insolvent to take care of their families, et cetera. There is an increase. Now, we have always had poor people among us. We have always had pacis pyre, which is pacis pyre is Latin for little production. That's what poverty means, or poor means. Pacis pyre means little production. We've always had famine in the land, but there's going to be an increase when its third seal is being broken. Let's continue. When the Lamb opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of a fourth living creature saying, "Come." And I looked, and there before me was a pale horse. Its rider was named Death and Hades, and was following close behind him. And they were given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine, and plague, and by wild beasts on the earth. And so notice, I want you to notice something before I explain this. Notice that the first three seals is concerning something taking place in the spiritual realm. So that's why you find that even most interpret the seal as something only, you know, happening, you know, it just happened in the spiritual realm. I agree with them, right? It does just happen just in the spiritual realm. But I want you to notice the effects of the second and the third seals. Notice that there's a sword and a famine are mentioned. But notice mentioned here, there is plague and wild beasts that's included, which is implying that these indeed are grow worse over time. Because you'll find in the following seals, you'll see the same sword. You'll see the same other type of thing. But notice they are added here. What's added to the fourth seal is plagues and wild beasts on the earth. Again, they are added. So how can really the seals really have any significance at the time when Yahushua is just taken up? And after we begin to look at this here, you're going to understand that this really kind of points in time already. There's something that has already happened. So we see wars, we have saw famine, we saw plagues. That's nothing new, right? We've always said saw plagues and famine and wars. We have always seen all these type of calamities already. And so, but I believe that they actually begin to increase from that moment on. When the Mashiach was delivered unto heaven, they began to increase, progressively increase over time. And so whether they are open at the time of Yahushua's ascension or in the end times, people feel that it's an end time. No matter what you believe, no matter what your perspective is when it comes to these here, we know that wars, famine, all those things aren't new. But one of the things I want you all to see is that all of these increase, the frequency of all these things increase over time, right? And we begin to see them in severity. We begin to see an increase in these over time, all right? Now, let's look at the next two seals. So really four really have two and three in it. It's just added plagues as well as the beast of the earth, the beast of the earth. Let's continue. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain because the word of Yah and the testimony they had maintained. And they called out a loud voice, "How long, sovereign master, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" What's going to happen? Our blood is going to be avenged through slavery, Jim Crow, from being exilic people, from being held in captivity here, going back to Egypt, going back to Assyrian, going back to Persia, going back to Babylon, going back to the Greeks, going back to the Romans, going back to all type of laws and all type of hanging us from trees. The scripture says that the inhabitants of the earth is going to, our blood is going to be avenged. Verse 11, to each of them was given a white robe And they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed, who were to be killed, who were to be killed. So I want to make this announcement to Israelites, to those individuals who are keeping the laws, statutes, and commandments, to native-born Israelites and those who have pleaded for Israelites. There's a chance you're going to be killed. Everybody's quoting Psalms Division 91. Everybody's talking about protection. Everybody's talking about 1,000 going to fall at my side, 10,000 at my right hand. I'm going to be kept. I can show you precept after precept. That's not all of us are going to survive the Great Tribulation, because some of us is going to be killed. Notice it says, as they had been, was completed, which means this has been a progressiveness. We have been killed all the day long. We have always been killed, but I'm telling you, that's why there's going to be vengeance. That's why the scripture says, vengeance is mine, said Yah, I will repay. Vengeance is coming for the bloodshed, for raping our women, for sodomizing our men, for using our babies as alligator bait, for having vaginal procedures on our women, unnecessized, to hanging us from trees, to skinning our bodies and making that skin out of shoes, Negro skin shoes, and our blood is going to be avenged. It's going to be avenged. That's why the time of the Gentile is short. It's coming to an end. Watch this. Let's continue. All right. I'm sorry. I didn't go there. Where are we? Okay. We're still talking about the fifth seal. Each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed as they had been were completed, until it was completed. So here we see what appears to be the present tense event at the time that Yahusha actually opened this seal. We see even a brief conversation that take place with those involved, and they are told to wait until a future time. They're ready, but they've been told, wait till a future time. And they were told to wait until the number, watch this, of their fellow, watch this, see it, servants and what? And brothers who were to be killed as they had been was completed. So this definitely lends to the credence to the fact that this was the previous seal were probably the most possibly to be opened, I should say, in the same time, not just throughout history. So this is at the same time these are being opened. These seals are being opened back to 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 back. So all these are spiritual events that took place. And then, of course, we see the previous seals were at the same time frame as the fifth seal. So all of these are back to back to back to back to back to back to back, all right? Not just over a period of time, but we see this as being connected to one another as they're going off. I'm going to show you that even with the trumpets too. We see a progressive sound of the trumpets, a progressive sound over and over and over of the trumpets, because they are being released. They are being released. Plagues are being released on the earth. So notice that here, they were told to wait until the number of the fellow saints and brothers who were to be killed as they had been was completed. So just like the other seals speak of the events that they have already been in existence. So the fifth seal speak of those who have been killed because of the word of Yah. These are the commandment keepers. These are the ones who have kept the laws, who have kept the commandments, right? So there's no doubt that many had already been killed for the word of the Most High up until that time, right? So since that time, Yahusha, we see a lot of people being martyred, right? Throughout time, being martyred, right? So we see that same principle is applied here as in the first four seals. So though the fifth seal, it speaks about a future event, It is the same seal that if you put them all, when you put them all together, they're being released at the same time. So it's the first four is kind of together. The fifth seal we see kind of more like a future event, right? Let's go continue. He says, and I watched, and he will open a sixth seal, and there was an earthquake, a great earthquake, and the sun turned black like the sackcloth made of goat hair, and the wool and the whole moon turned blood red. Verse 13, and the stars in the sky fell to earth, and the lake figs dropped from the fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. Verse 14, and the sky receded like a scroll, peeled back, rolling up, and every mountain island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth, the princes, the generals, the rich, the mighty, and the very slave, and every slave, and every free man hid in caves among the rocks of the mountain. And they call the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? Now, I've heard many, many Christian apologists say, yeah, this is the day of the Lord. Or they talk about Sunday being the day of the Lord. Sunday is the day of the Lord. And when they really read Revelation in its proper context, you begin to see that this day of Yahuwah or the day of the Lord, folks, it's not talking about no Sunday. Had nothing to do with Sunday. That is a twisted doctrine, right? We don't see that at all, right? Let's look again, verse 12. Let's see what this is about. The sake of verse 12. I watched as he opened the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun turned black like a sackcloth made of goat hair, and the whole moon turned blood red. The whole moon turned blood red. Now, let me ask you all a question really quickly. Does this line up with Yahushua's coming? Let me read it again. And there was a great earthquake. This is where a lot of pre-tribs get a lot of their theology from. And the sun turned black like a sackcloth made of goat hair. And the whole moon turned blood red. My question is, does this really line up with the return of the Mashiach? By the blood turning red, do they line up with the Mashiach return? Okay, you're pondering it. All right. You're pondering it. All right. Let's go back here. And let's deal with this here, because that's what many people tend to think. All right. They tend to think that's just really talking about the day of Yahushua. But I want you to notice something. That the sun turned what? Black. And the moon turned into blood. Now, we should be able to find a precept of that as well. Because all things, folks, we know the end from the beginning. And everything that has been done is going to be done again. Everything that has been said is going to be said again. We see that, all right? So let's get Joel. Let's see what Joel says about this here, all right? As we can compare the two. As we compare the two. Joel says, the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon to what? Blood before the coming and the great and dreadful day of Yahuwah. So I'm asking you again, does this line up with the return of the Mashiach? I got to see your some of your notes.
Some of you said before.
Okay, so you see the Mashiach coming back before then.
no, it's the when this stuff transpired, it's before the Mashiach become. I mean, will be coming.
Let's see what this is. Are we dealing with the plagues yet? Are we dealing with the trumpets yet? What are we dealing with now? What is the context? The seals. So I mention again. So do the Mashiach come before the seals? How can he open up the seals and come back at the same time?
These are plagues.
Oh, no. No, these aren't plagues. These are seals. Seals.
Did you ask, was these the plagues or the seals?
No, these are the seals. So seals come before the plagues.
Comes after the plagues.
Because the seals in as it is in Exodus, it was darkened.
That's right. I'm going to show you something because this is where a lot of people go off on. Because when they look and say, yep, this is the day of the Lord. This is the return of the Lord. Or they'll say the Lord's day, which is Sunday. But this is the dreadful day of the Lord. He's coming back.
I said no.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I got you. Because again, this is in the sixth seal. During the sixth seal, have the trumpets been blown yet? The seven trumpets. Have they been blown yet?
No.
No, they have not. So I'm going to ask you again. Is this the coming of the Mashiach?
No.
We see it here.
No.
We also see a precept in Joel chapter 2. We see a precept on that, and the precept is the great and dreadful day. And we see again, the moon is going to turn, it's going to be darkened. All right, we see that, right? Y'all see that? So let's see what the Mashiach said himself. Okay. Immediately after the distress of those days, Matthew chapter 24, 29 through 30, the sun will be what? Darkened. The moon would not give its what? Light. The stars have fallen from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. And at that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky and all the nations of the earth will mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of sky with great power and great glory. I want you to notice something at his return. We see the sun is only darkened in the moon, would not give us light at all. So clearly, this is not discussing or talking about Yahushua's coming, his return. Because the sun is only darkened. Do I need to go through that again? Right? The sun should be darkened here in Matthew chapter 24. Other verses, it's the moon that's going to be darkened. Right? It says nothing about the sun being darkened, does it? And Joel, as well as Revelation, don't say anything about the sun being darkened. Let's read it again. Let's read it again. When it's coming, pardon me, and immediately after those stress those days, the sun shall be darkened. The sun should be darkened, and we of course know the moon will not give forth its light, but the sun shall be darkened. Let's go back to Revelation. And the kings of the earth, the princes and the generals and the rich and the mighty and every slave and every free man hid in caves among the rocks of the mountain. They call to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide from us the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Verse 17, and for the great day of their wrath has come. Who can stand? Wait a minute. I want to show you why this is not the coming of the Mashiach. This is not him returning. Because here it says that the kings of the earth, the princes, and the generals, what are they doing? They're hiding underground. Do this sound like the Battle of Armageddon?
No.
No, not at all, right? Because we know at Yahushua's return, it's a much different picture with the kings and their armies, because they're making war against him. You want a precept, you can go to Psalm Division 2. You all have heard me teach on that for quite some time. Because what are the kings doing now? They're hiding. What are they going to be doing when Demashiach return? They're going to help rage war against him. That's going to be Armageddon, right? Let's get a precept on that. Revelation chapter 16. Then I saw three evil spirits that looked like frogs that came out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet. And they are spirits of demons performing miracle signs, and they go out to the kings of the whole world to gather them for the battle of the great day of Yah Almighty. And behold, I come like a thief. Blessed is he who stays awake and keep the clothes with him, so that he may not go naked and shamefully exposed. Going right back to, remember, the 10 foolish virgins who's waiting on the bridegroom. Revelation chapter 6, verse 16. And then they gathered the kings together to place them to that place that in Hebrew is called what? Armageddon. So the kings are hiding in the previous verses. They're hiding. But we know, of course, when he's returned, that's when they're going to rage war against Demashiach, right? Armageddon. Let's get another precept. And I saw an angel standing in the sun who cried in a loud voice to all the birds flying in midair, come, gather together for a great supper of Yah, so that they may eat the flesh of kings, generals, and mighty men, and horses, and riders, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, small and great. Then I saw the beasts and the kings of the earth and their armies do what? Gather together to make war against who? The rider on the horse and his army. So during the seals, while they're being opened, the kings of the earth are hiding. But when the Mashiach return, they are making war against the Mashiach. So when we talk about this sixth seal, it's not talking about the return of the Mashiach, right? It's not talking about that. In fact, let's get Revelation chapter 6, verse 17. Particularly if you look at it in this light. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? Let me say this again. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? So one of the things I often go back to my seminary days and begin to look at terms, particularly Hebrew and Greek terms, and do a word study or an analysis on a word. So I begin to study, what is this word day? So notice, for the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? Right, still talking about the seals. This word day here, it is chimera. Now, chimera, it simply means a time or a period. Not necessarily a single day, but it's a time or a period. A time or a period. So if we put that back in its proper context, let's read it again. For the great time, not day, for the great time or period of their wrath has come, and who can stand? So that's why you have to rightly divide the word of truth, because if not, you're going to come up with all type of convoluted ideas and convoluted theories and ideologies and opinions about the scriptures, and you're going to build your own dogma that does not pass the scrutiny of the scriptures. So that's why it requires each of us to have what we call the jurisprudence of the scripture, line upon line, precept upon precept, here little, there little, as well as because of the scriptures we read is read or is translated in what we call Teutonic language or Greek or Latin. We got to do our due diligence. We have to make sure we go through a jurisprudence process where we begin to scrutinize various words and look at the etymological meaning. So again, this word chimera, it means a period or a time. So when you see that word for the great day, it's, oh yeah, it's a day. It's a day, it's a great day of the Lord, and he's gonna return. But no, that means a period or a great time in which he is coming. So this is really declaring that the beginning of the end has started. So when the seals are open, this is the beginning of the end. And so when you look at these events, it kind of begins what take place of the return of Mashiach. That's why you said, when you see these signs, do know that your redemption draweth nigh. What signs? The signs of the times. So only thing that the seals are, they are the signs of the times. That's all they are, all right? And so we got to make sure that we understand that itself, because when you look at a serious event, you're going to see kings, you're going to see generals, and they ain't going to be hiding. Nope, they ain't going to be hiding at all. They're not going to be hiding for their, you know, selves, you know, underground for their protection. Nope, they're going to come from out of the mountains. Right? Let's look at verse 14. The sky receded like a scroll, rolling up, and every mountain and every island was removed from its place. So when you look at all of the seals, I want you to think what's going to really give birth to this is a massive earthquake. I'm talking about on a global scale that have tremendous implications. So we already read that the closer we get to the trumpets, we know what's going to kick the trumpets off. It's going to be what? It's going to be a massive earthquake, as we dealt with last week, right? Because scripture says every mountain and every island, what's going to happen? It's going to be moved. It's going to shift. Every island, every mountain is going to shift. That's what an earthquake does. It shifts the land, right? It quakes and it shifts the entire land, right? So this is before Yahushua returned, right? This is before his return, right? When he returned, those are the closing acts, all right? Those are the closing acts, but this turn. So let's do a quick review, right quick. Because what we talked about in here, we talked about the time of breaking the seals, right? And that it's just during the time as Yahushua is arriving to heaven. So that's why we see John said, there's nobody in heaven that can open it. There's nobody on the earth or under the earth. But it does not say there's no one above the earth or under the heaven. It does not say that. Why? Because John is in a spiritual, he's caught up in a spiritual vision. He's in a vision. And at that time, he doesn't see the Mashiach in heaven. But then he sees him and said, now he's the one who's worthy to open up these seals, right? And that's when we begin to see these things happen here, right? We also talked about how the first five seals were opened, right? And that the events that follow these seals, and they're going to be increasing. They have always been. We always have wars. We've always had murder. We have already had nation against nation, but they're going to increase. That's how you know the seals are being opened, because what they do is they increase. There's an increasing of them. We also talked about that some of them reveal what's going to happen in the future. So the first four are what's happened in the spirit. But then we see the fourth or the fifth seal, we see some things happening there in terms of the saints who are yet to be killed, right? Who's going to join them in battle, all right? So let's go back to Matthew chapter 24, right? Let's get some more precept on this, all right? Matthew chapter 24. Nation will rise against what? Nation. Kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. In various places. I'm going to say that one more time. In various places. They're going to be in various places. All right? Let's go back so you can fully understand. Let's go back to verse 5. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Mashiach, and shall deceive many. Verse 6. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not armed. Alarmed, pardon me. You better be armed. You are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come, right? So we see that there is wars. Of course, we shouldn't be surprised by that because it always happened. But what he's saying is there's going to be an increase in wars. There was wars before the Mashiach. There were wars after the Mashiach. But what he's saying is it's going to increase, right? As we saw in what was the second or third seal? We saw it in the third seal, right? And so, but when the Mashiach said, when you see all these things, he said, do know that this is the beginning of the birthing or the birth pains, as we call it, the beginning of birth pains. Birth pains is going to happen, right? It's not deliverance yet, but it's going to be birth pains that's going to occur. That's the beginning of it when you see this here. All right, that's the beginning. So Matthew 7, 24, 7, and 8, let's go back to this one. Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and earthquakes in various places, in various places. And all these are the beginning of birth pains, of birth pains. To be honest, I believe that the seals are being opened and we are in birth pains. We ain't seen the plague yet. We ain't seen it because we know that it's going to a whole, as we studied last week, a whole mountainous country is going to fall into the sea. We ain't seen that yet, right? We ain't seen that yet. So we got to begin to follow this. Scripture says here, Mashiach said, these are the beginning of birth pains, right? Birth pains. Now look at verse 7, and I want you to see something. I said, pay attention to various places. Various places, because it mentioned famines and earthquakes in various places. Now, that word various places is kata topos, which actually is translated according to the passages. Let me say that again. So when the Mashiach said there's going to be famine and there's going to be earthquakes in various places, what he's really saying is kata topos, right? In kata, it literally means, the context means against or down or according to. It's used over 300 times in the Brit Hadashah. Over 300 times, it means according to. Uh-oh. So let's try to read that again. The Mashiach said, there will be famines and earthquakes according to. We haven't dealt with places yet. We just deal with various. Various is kata. Places is typos, where we get typology from land, earth, geography, geology, etc. I used to study in college, in undergraduate school, typology. Typology means the study of land or the study of ground. So let's slow down a little bit. There will be famines and earthquakes in according to what? Before we go there, let's look at some places where we see the term kata, right? Kata. To one, here's Matthew chapter 25, verse 12. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to the other 2 talents, and another 1 talent, each according, that's the same word, according, the word various, that the Mashiach used there is the same word according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. Let's get another one. Mark chapter 7, verse 5. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law asked Yahushua, why don't your disciples live according to kata, to the tradition of the elders, instead of eating their food with unclean hands. Let's get another one. Luke chapter 1. Say, he was chosen by lot according, that's the word kata, to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of Yahuwah and burn incense. So we can see over and over and over this word kata is used as various. Let's look at the next one, right? Topos. Topos. And it means, pending the context, carries the meaning of a place, position, an opportunity, or a passage. A passage is used only five times in the Brit Hadashah. Three of those five are of this account found in Matthew chapter 24, quoted by the Mashiach, which also is in Mark chapter 3, as well as Luke chapter 21. The other two are found in Acts chapter 27 regarding the journey of Paul, which is clearly has the context of referring to a place or a position. So when we look at the context, whether we're talking about in Netanyahu or Matthew or Mark or Luke, we see this word kata, right? And it does not mean various, but it means according to. According to. So it makes more sense for the Mashiach that he's referring to scriptures here. What the prophet said here. Because that's that word. That's why your English, Germanic Bibles really do the Mashiach and the prophets a grave disservice. It takes time to study this. You're going to have to be like a workman that needed not to be ashamed. It takes laborious effort. It takes rigorous research, shrewd scholarship. It takes discipline to study the scriptures, to rightly divide the word of truth, right? Because now you begin to see what the Mashiach is really saying here, right? We know that he said there's going to be famines and there's going to be earthquakes according to the scriptures. All right. So let's read it in its proper context. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes according to the scriptures. So it's not in various places. When you really fully, you know, many of them were very sloppy in their effort to translate the scriptures. And so many times they transliterated it based off sound and phonetics. So we call that Septuagint. Septuagint, when 70 scholars, supposedly scholars, translated the scriptures out of Hebrew and Aramaic into Greek. And so we see that. And then, of course, we find the Vulgate Bible with St. Jerome as it was transcribed or translated into Latin. And then from there, we find the Geneva Bible. And so all throughout, then Europeans just kind of took that over. So we know that it got diluted over the years. So what when you read Matthew chapter 24, I want you to read it like this, because that's on the proper terms, right? Kata topos, which is nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes according to the scriptures. So that's why Yahusha said that earthquakes would be considered really a part of the beginning of birth pains for the end times. That's why it's parallel with the scriptures we just went over, right? Particularly Revelation chapter 6, verse 14. We just dealt with that, right? And the sky receded in a scroll, rolling up, and every mountain and island was what? Removed, which means it shifted. The land shifted. The mountain shifted. That makes sense what the Mashiach is saying, right? It makes sense. And when you put that in its proper context, that there will be famines and earthquakes according to Torah, according to the scriptures, on a global scale, it's going to shake the entire earth. So he's referring basically what the prophets said regarding to the earthquakes. And there are many passages in terms of what the the prophet said about earthquakes that's going to rock the entire earth, which is, it really is a precept of Revelation chapter 6 and verse 14. All right, so I want you to look at that. So even when we go to Isaiah, Isaiah talked about earthquakes and what's going to happen and global earthquakes and what will happen. Isaiah chapter 24. Let's get this here. Isaiah chapter 24. Right? In fact, the whole chapter, but I'm only going to use just the middle part, but the whole chapter is lavish in terms of really explaining what earthquakes is, or if the whole earth is going to be shaken by an earthquake. Isaiah chapter 24. So you know the Mashiach is always quoting Torah. That's why most of his speech is either allusions or direct quotes of Torah. Either he's directly quoting Torah or he is alluding to something that happened in Torah, right? Let's get a precept on that. Isaiah chapter 24, verse 19. And the earth is broken up. The earth is split asunder. The earth is thoroughly shaken. The earth reels like a drunkard back and forth. That's an earthquake, right? It sways like the hut in the wind. So heavy upon it is the guilt of the rebellion that it falls, never to rise again. And in the day of, there the word again, in the day of the Lord, or the day of Yahuwah, will punish the powers in the heavens above and the kings on the earth below. So not only do we see a global earthquake, but we see what? Punishment of the kings, right? The very thing, same thing we saw in Revelation chapter 6, verse 15. We saw that there. Let's continue. Let's go on a little further. Isaiah chapter 24 and 23 says, and the moon was abased and the sun ashamed, for Yahuwah Almighty will reign upon Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before his elders gloriously. And so when we look at this at first glance, I just want you to glance at it, because you would think it's talking about the return of the Mashiach. Yeah, see, the Mashiach is going to return. He's going to punish everybody. But we thought the same thing in Revelation chapter 6. But it's not. This is where a lot of people who are pre-trib, this is where they wrestle and they keep tripping over the scriptures, because they don't look at it in line upon line. They don't look at it in its proper context. You got to understand the pretext and the post-text if you want to have a full understanding of the context. If not, you're going to proof text the scriptures, right? You're going to proof text the scriptures. And so when we look at this here, the same, this is not talking about the coming of the Mashiach. That's wrong. Whoever taught you that, I invite them, let's study together. That's why Isaiah chapter 1 said, let's reason together. Let's reason together. Because it's even hard to find a Hebrew word. I was kind of looking for a Hebrew word for abash and ashamed. And it's kind of hard to kind of find, you know, than the rest of all the Hebrew texts. It's kind of, so both of them really carry the meaning of ashamed. They both do, right? They carry that meaning of being ashamed. So they both were carrying this whole embarrassment or shame, just two different words. But notice what the last part of this verse says. For Yahuwah Almighty will reign on Mount Zion, right? In Jerusalem, and before the elders gloriously. So what people will imply is that this is referring to the coming of Yahusha. He's going to reign in Jerusalem. He's going to sit on the mighty throne. He's going to come. However, right, you got to begin to look at the fact that this statement is looking forward to the day and is not declaring that it has arrived as a result of it. This is not uncommon, particularly to have such a statement made surrounding these particular passages itself. And what really led us to the conclusion regarding Isaiah chapter 24 is, I think that we see the intent of this event is not the return of the Mashiach, because it's given to us in the first verses of the chapter. Let's go to it. See, Yahuwah is going to lay waste the earth and devastate it. He will ruin its face and shatter its inhabitants. It will be the same for the priests as for the people, for the masters as for the servants, for the mistress as for the maid, for the seller and for the buyer, for the borrower and the lender, for the debt, the debtor and the creditor. And the earth will completely lay to waste and totally plunder it. Yahuwah has spoken his word. So notice that verse 1 shows us that the inhabitants of the earth are what? Scattered. They're scattered at Yahusha's. But at Yahusha's return, are they scattered? No, they're not scattered. They're gathered. He's going to gather and destroy. There's no scattering. He's going to gather. And so there's many ways we can look at this, because this is specifically dealing with, it's not the return of the Mashiach. This is stuff that happens before the Mashiach. These are the seals. These are the plagues that's being broken. This is before the Mashiach, right? When you begin to look at it in its proper context, right? In the proper context itself. And so I believe it fit perfectly with where Mashiach we just read, right, in Matthew chapter 24, that's the beginning of birth pains. And it's going to usher in the days of the anti-Mashiach or the anti-Christ. Let's get verse 5 and 6, right? As I was reading that, it was blown away by it. The earth is defiled by its people. They have disobeyed what? The laws, violated the statutes, and broken the everlasting covenant. What kind of covenant? Everlasting covenant. Therefore, a curse consumes the earth. Its people must bear their guilt. Therefore, earth's inhabitants are burned up, and very few are left. That means there are still people left. So that's why we got to read in context. Take our time, look at the circumference of any text, as we used to say, the pericope of the text. Look at it so you can properly be skilled at exegeting the scripture, because there's going to be still people left. I'm going to say it again. There's still people left. And so we know there's going to be a global earthquake that's really going to kick this stuff off, folks. When you see a global earthquake, we know that the end times, they are here. And here's what Isaiah said: the people must bear their guilt. They must bear their guilt. Let me go back to Matthew chapter 24. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in according to the scriptures. And all these are the beginning of birth pains. Now, one thing I want you to notice is nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom. It's not just really telling us that we will hear about wars and rumors of wars, but that we are not to be alarmed. But notice what he said happens here. He said, but the end is still to come. But the end is still to come. Let's see this. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. It's still to come. Now, my question to you, where was I? Yeah, the scripture. What's the difference between nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom compared to wars and rumors of wars? Now, before you answer that, I want you to notice that the word nations is not plural. The word kingdom is not plural. They're singular in both cases. This is when your hard diligence, your hard work pays off. Your laborious efforts in terms of studying the scripture line upon line. Don't skip and just read scripture as scripture. Read a line upon line, and then get a precept on it. Line upon line, get a precept on it. Line upon line, and then get a proper precept on it. Let's look at nation and look at kingdom, right? Nation and kingdom. Nation is the Greek word ethnos, meaning nation, people, or Gentile. Then we find kingdom is where we get the word basileia. Anybody ever heard of the basilica in Rome, right? We find St. Peter's, you know, basilica. We find that, and it actually means kingdom. It means kingdom here. So Yahushua distinguished the difference between nations and kingdoms, and he even keeps them singular in this text. Singular, implying that there will be one specific nation against another specific nation. How we read it, they're gonna be nations rising up against nations. But in the proper context, there's nation that will rise up against nation. And watch this, kingdom, go back to it, kingdom against kingdom. So there's gonna be a kingdom that rises up against another kingdom. There's gonna be a specific nation that rises up against another nation. And so it's really talking about, when you understand it, it's really the kingdom of the enemy versus the kingdom of Yahuwah. I pour that out for you. I don't wanna spoil them next week, but I'm gonna pour that out as to why the Mashiach said, everything gotta be proved line upon line, precept upon precept. Now, let me finish these seals and we'll get to it. So we know the sixth seal seems to really kind of trigger the start of the end time, right? This is when everything kind of is sprung into motion, right? During the sixth seal of Revelation, right? When we get into chapter 7 of Revelation, we then begin to see how the seven takes a break and it separates from the sixth and the seventh seal. Now, let's look at the seventh seal, because I think the seventh seal has a lot of significance here, all right? The seventh seal here as it was broken. So when we talk about Revelation chapter 8, verse 1, when he opened the seventh seal, there was a silence in the heaven for about a half an hour. And I wrestle with that because the scripture doesn't speak in terms of, although we know the scriptures are full of hyperboles, it's full of similes, it's full of synecdoches and metonymies, and speak metaphorically and anthropomorphism. You see a lot of that in the scriptures. The scripture really don't use about. Yah is very specific. He typically don't use about a half an hour. But it's something about the breaking of the seventh seal that's really revealing what's going to take place in the seventh trumpet, right? Because it's the seventh seal here that gives details that kind of spell out the events that take place in the sixth. When we deal with the sixth seal, so we look at the sixth seal to all these things that happened, but really, what happened in the seventh seal? What the seventh seal do, it really spells out all these things. It spells out how they're going to take place in detail. That's all it does. So when you're reading Revelation, I don't want you to get confused in that, because only thing it's doing, it is spelling out what it has, what's going to take place. Of course, it's spelling out everything that has happened in the sixth seal, all right, in the sixth seal. So I want you to even, people say, well, put a precept on that. I love giving precepts so people can understand it, all right? So when we talk about, go back to the days of creation with Adam and Eve, and the scripture says that he was created, he creates man on the what? Sixth day. He creates him on the sixth day. So we know that Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, so Yah created man in his own image. In the image, Yah, he created male and female, he created them. But not much is given in terms of how he created them, right? It's not until we get into chapter 2 that we find a detailed account in terms of how they are created, All right. How the details as to what happened on the sixth day. That's the same principle here with the sixth seal and the seventh seal. Because if the sixth seal is truly happening or is the beginning of the end of judgment, then it will make sense because the seventh seal now began to open up for what? The trumpets to be blown. So let's read this again. When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in the heaven for about in half an hour. Now that's what baffled me. I understood everything, but what baffled me was this term about. Why would the scripture says about a half an hour? I thought about, you know, are we seeing it through the lens and the eyes of your boy Yochanan? And that he didn't, you know, because he's limited and he didn't have real detailed information. But then I thought about it. I said, well, everything else was very detailed. Everything he gave about the beast and about the creatures and how they look, it was detail oriented. Why did he mention about a half finale here? Because usually when Yah deals with time, he's very specific when it comes to time. And so I don't want you to focus on that part of this because you'll miss kind of the revelation that comes out of this here. Because what we should be reading instead of about, close to, or any of those things, right? We need to be focusing on the silent part because a half an hour we're going to come out. I'm going to show you how it's going to come out. Because when it's silence, focus on this term here, silence. There was silence. Let's read this again. And when he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in the heaven for about a half an hour. Now, I want you to consider something. Let's get a precept on that. I'm come back to that. Romans chapter 3, verse 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be what? Silence. And then the whole world held accountable to Yah. Now we know that whatever the law says, so far the law being done away with. It says to those who are under the law, so it's only going to say to those who are under the law, that every mouth be silent and the whole world be held accountable to Yah, right? So when we talk about a half an hour of silence, right, this is giving people time to repent, to turn from their wicked ways, to teshuva, return back to the law. Yah, before judgment come, Yah is giving people an opportunity to get it right. This is last chance to get it clean. Last chance to stop fornicating. Last chance to follow the law, statutes, and commandments. Last chance to stop committing adultery. Last chance not to break the Decalogue or the Ten Commandments. The last chance not to break the laws of the Most High. He's giving one last chance, because there's never silence in the heavens unless he's given people an opportunity to repent. He's given opportunity people to repent and turn from their ways. So that's why we know that Yah is the same yesterday, today, and forever, right?
That's right.
Is he the same?
Hallelujah.
Okay, if he's the same, let's see if he's the same. Let's see if this precept holds true in Torah. Let's get Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 10. When you march up to attack a city, notice it's a law, make its people an offer of peace. And if they refuse to make peace and they engage with you in battle, lay siege to that city. You go to war and you take over that city. So he gave Israel specific instructions to offer peace before you engage into battle with anybody else. If peace is to be offered before you go in and wipe that city out, part of the law is you must give them an opportunity. There must be silence. There must be a time for them to have, you must offer a peace agreement with them. Offer them peace. But if they don't refuse your peace agreement, you go in and you lightning gonna bump the stump. You go in and you make war and you take them out. So it's the same light. Of course, we can see this again over and over in terms of the scripture. Let's look at it in the Brit Hadashah, because there always should be precept upon precept. Everything I say, it should be backed up. It should be proven. Scripture says, prove all things, test all things to see if they are of God. So Luke chapter 14, verse 31. Or suppose a king who is about to go to war against another king, while he is not first to sit down and consider whether he is able with the 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000. Watch this. If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Notice what the Mashiach continued to do. He continued to quote Torah. So when we go back and we look at this here, it's the same thing in terms of Revelation chapter 8. The same thing that he's offering the world. Here's an opportunity for peace. This is your last chance to accept the terms of peace before you face judgment. That's why after the seven seal, what comes? Judgment. This, I'm telling you, everybody that I know who said the law is done away with, they should be shaking in their boots. This should be a time to come to the Most High. This should be a come to Yahusha meeting, as he used to say. This is the time to come to him, because it's giving you an opportunity before judgment fall. It's giving you this opportunity, this last time to make it right, because judgment is going to come. How do we know? Ezekiel chapter 18. I was reading this morning. I said, it's perfect with this lesson. It says, for Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 32, for I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares sovereign Yahuwah. Repent and live. Repent and live. That I'm giving you an opportunity to teshuva, to make it right before the Most High, to confess your sins and return back to his laws, statutes, and commandments. I'm giving you an opportunity to do this. So if we're going to be in harmony with the scriptures, we got to begin to look at this word silence in Revelation chapter 8. It's really bearing significance of, or the emphasis should not be put on the half an hour. The emphasis should be placed on what silence is. It's for peace, right? So that's why we see in Revelation, of course, and we'll pick up on it next week. We see seven angels, of course, and then we see seven trumpets coming forth. And we see angels blowing their trumpets, as we read last week. And we see if we go to the Revelation chapter 18, we'll find that there are how angels are coming to and fro. And I think last week we talked about the censer with fear, with fire, and you know, from the altar, and it fell from heaven, and I'm paraphrasing. And as a result, there was an earthquake that took place. So, right? So you can see all these things that is explaining the earthquake. It's explaining all these things in the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth seal, but it actually happened during the seventh seal, because the seventh seal is an opening of what? The seventh trumpet. And what is the first thing that happened during the seventh trumpet? An earthquake. There's an earthquake that happened. And so that's why you should always, that's why the Most High always offer peace before the trumpet begins. That's why there's silence in the heavens, because he's offering peace, an opportunity to get it right, because we know that trumpets signify what? War. There's going to be war during to this global earthquake. Let me get a precept on that. It says Jeremiah chapter 4. Oh, my anguish. Right in the pain. Oh, the agony of my heart. My heart's pound within me. I cannot keep silent. I cannot keep what? Silent. I cannot keep silent. For I have heard the sound of the trumpet. I have heard the battle cry. Disaster follows disaster. Whenever you hear that trumpet, it's war. Whenever you hear that trumpet, it's disaster that follows. Disaster follows disaster. The whole land lies in ruins, and in an instant, my tents are destroyed, and my shelter is in a moment. How long must I see the battle standard and hear the sound of the trumpet? Why I continue to hear these trumpets? Why am I hearing these trumpets over and over and over and over? Why? It's because these are the first five trumpets in Revelation. And they're happening one after, as we explained last week, one after the other, one after the other. Then, and that all takes place in one day. You're hearing a trumpet, boop, trumpet, boop, trumpet, boop. That's why, let's continue to read. My people are fools. You old fish eye fool, you. He said, my people are fools. They do not know me. They are sinless children. They have no understanding. They are skilled in doing evil. He's talking about Israel, folks. They know not how to do good. They are lying generation. They're stiff-necked people. I looked at the earth, and it was formless and empty, and at the heavens, and their light was gone. Their light was gone. The light of the world, the salt of the earth, the children of the Most High, their light was gone. And I looked at the mountains, and they were quaking. All the hills were swaying. That's a precept. I looked, and there were no people. Every bird in the sky had flown away or died because of the 5G radiation rays. All right. And I looked, and the fruitful land was a desert, and all of his town lay in ruins before Yahuwah, before his fierce anger. Verse 27. This is what Yahuwah says. The whole land is ruined, though I will not destroy it completely. I will not do what? Destroy it completely. Therefore, the earth will mourn and the heavens above grow dark, because I have spoken and will not relent. I have decided and I will not turn back. So you can see how easily in Jeremiah easily parallels with what we just read, what? In Isaiah chapter 24. Right? And that parallels with what? The first five trumpets that are blown after the seventh seal. So my question is, I guess my last question is, do we know what day that this is going to happen on? Because we know, as I said before, I started off this lesson tonight stating that the Father deals with us in patterns. He revealed his hands through patterns. He revealed his revelation through patterns. What if I told you that this is in conjunction with the feast days? We all know that deliverance came to our ancestors in Egypt. In Mizraim, on the first day of what? The unleavened bread. First day of unleavened bread. That's what happened, right? So I wonder if this is going to be the first day of the unleavened bread here, because we know the end from the beginning. Well, let's go back to even Lot in Sodom. Remember the two angels who came to deliver them? Let's get a precept on that. And the two angels arrived at Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gateway of the city. And when he saw them, he got up to meet them and bowed down with his face to the ground. My lords, he said, please turn aside your servant's house. You can wash your feet and spend the night, and then go on your way early in the morning? No, they answered, we will spend the night in the square. Verse 3. But he insisted so strongly that they did not go with him and entered in his house. He prepared a meal for them. Let's see what kind of meal he prepared for them. Unleavened bread. Baking bread without yeast. And they ate. Now, this is before what we call the covenant. This is before Moshe, right? This is Lot. This is Abraham's nephew. This is way before then. Notice in verse 1, it says, in the evening. It said, in the evening in verse 1. And then, of course, verse 3, it says, he prepared a meal for them. I want you to see how Yah, that everything, folks, I promise you, everything, there's nothing new under the sun. Yah is very methodical, very systematic. He's a Yah who he lets you know what's going to happen by his appointed times, by his feast days. So notice it wasn't a regular meal. What kind of meal was it? It specifically deal with bread without yeast. So when bread is made without yeast, it's for one of the following commandments of the Most High. The Feast of the Unleavened Bread. And so that's why the whole phrase, you know, breaking bread without yeast, was up. It was simply added to let us know what time it actually was. When you read the scriptures with the appointed times in mind, it jumps off the page. Things become very transparent. Things become very raw and real. Things become very, you get points of clarity. You understand the scriptures when you read the scriptures with the appointed times in mind, right? So keep that in mind, right? So it's the same way. So that means if I say something like turkey with dressing, immediately you all think about what? Although we don't, in this country, you know, we don't observe Thanksgiving, but most, the average person is going to think of what? Thanksgiving, Thanksgiving Day. So when you think about feasts or you talk about bread without yeast, immediately what comes to mind is the Feast of the Unleavened. So verse 1 shows what? It's in the evening, because that's when we eat unleavened bread, right? That's when we eat the Passover meal. It's always in the evening. It's at when we're done with Passover, as we are finishing Passover, leading into the Feast of the Unleavened, that's when we eat unleavened bread, right? Unleavened bread. And so when you really begin to look at that, you read the entire, you go back in chapter 18, you'll begin to see where even Abraham prepared a meal with bread. And you'll see the same type of dynamic there earlier in the chapter. You'll begin to see that. And well, let me get that. All right, let me get that. All right. Genesis chapter 18. Is anything too hard for the Most High? I will return to you at an appointed time. At the appointed time. Let me say it again. At the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Everything the Most High does, he does it around his Moedims. He does it around his feast days. Everything he does. The Mashiach was born during Sukkot. He died during Passover. He was buried during the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. That's why he said, take, eat, this is my body. How is matzah bread or unleavened bread shaped? It has piercing and stripes, because the Mashiach body was going to be pierced and striped. Take for eating my, so he was making everything symbolic to the feast. That's why Paul likened his resurrection to what? The Feast of the First Fruit. So everything the Most High does, even the coming of the Mashiach, the Antichrist, our deliverance, is all linked to the Moeds. It's all into it. So notice it says the appointed time. We all know what that word appointed time is, don't we? Yes, we do. Because we know appointed, the word appointed is Moed. It's Moed. It's referring to the feast days. So the evening was the start, as I said before, of what? Of the unleavened bread. The next morning, we see what happened. We see Lot and his family. They are free. They get their deliverance from Sodom. They get their deliverance from Sodom. And so if we look here, it says, and I will make the descendants as numerous as the stars of the sky, will give them all of the lands through the offspring. All of the nations of the earth will be blessed because Abraham obeyed me and kept my what? Requirements or commandments, my decrees. And so what I say all the time is that although Moses received the written decrees and commands of the Most High, our people have already, when we went into captivity in Mizraim, we know that many of us forgot about it when we were in captivity, just like here in this land. We amalgamated to Christianity. We amalgamated to other things. But Abraham had always followed the commands. It's a precept here. Yah, the commandments were before Moshe. They were before Moses. Moses just had them written down, but there was oral tradition among our people. What to do and what not to do. We just see it in written form when we get to Moshe. When we get to Moshe. And I think I'll stop there, folks. I got a lot of things to talk about, and particularly when it comes to the days and how the days match up. And I think I'll pick up on that next week. So that we can have time for questions. But it's so much. I think I studied so much that we don't get a chance to really go over them all. But we're going to talk about this 1,290 days as talked about in Daniel and how you can read that in Revelation, all right? And how it adds up to these months or adds up to 3.5 years. And we know the Antichrist, the anti-Mashiach is going to rule for 3.5 years. So it all adds up. I teach all religions or comparative religions. So even Islamic eschatology, we talk about the root of the Mahdi, and it says he's going to rule for 1,290 days. Same thing that Daniel said. And we're going to find that in Revelation as well. But it takes some jurisprudence of the scriptures, and it takes really for us to be married to the scriptures. And I think I'll stop there. Because I'm supposed to stop, it was an hour ago, and if I keep going, I'm gonna go another hour and a half. But I'll bring it out next week and finish those things. Where am I? Am I still on? Can you all hear me?
Hello? Yes.
Yes, we can.
We can hear you.
I'm trying to, y'all. I thought I was really good in terms of technology, but I don't even see myself. Could you all see me?
No.
Yeah, we could see you while you was presenting your presentation.
Oh, you can?
We could. We don't now.
What about now?
Yeah, you there.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So we're gonna bring parallel all of these Old Testament or the Tanakh, the Torah and the prophets. We're going to tie them in with Revelation and what the Mashiach said. I want to show you some things like the 1,260 days. And then we're going to show you where the extra 30 days is added to that and why is those 30 days added to it. So when we look at Gematria, and we look at, that's why one of the books of the scriptures is called what? Numbers, right? So when you look at Numbers, Most High is so strategic. He's so methodical. He's predictable to those who know him and follow his laws, his statutes, and his moedims. So I'm gonna draw and show you how, even when we look at Moses received when the Most High spoke to him, I'm going to prove to you that that was during the time what we call Yom Teruah during the burning bush, right? That was the Yom Teruah. 10 days, it took them 10 days, right, to get before Pharaoh. 10 days after Yom Teruah, what feast do we celebrate? Or what is a yom? It's a day, pardon me. What day do we consider as the Moedim or the Moed or the appointed time of the Most High? Am I still there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Day of Atonement.
Day of Atonement, that's right. So 10 days after Yom Teruah, it's a Day of Atonement. So he went before Pharaoh. Said, Pharaoh, now it's time to let my people go to atone. Let my people go.
Right.
And what did Pharaoh do?
Hardened his heart.
At first he did what? He agreed. And then of course we know that Moses asked for provision for the feast that was coming up. So when you look at it in the scriptures, you all only see it when we read it in Leviticus, mm-hmm. right? 23 or Exodus chapter 23, that's when you see it, but it's before then. That's at the appointed times of the Most High. I just read to you where Abraham received the commandments before Moshe even received them on Mount Sinai. Because they're the appointed time, whether they're written or not, they've always been the Most High's appointed times, because we know the end from the beginning. That's what they do in movies. And movies, sometimes they start at the end of the movie. And then they continue to do scene after scene, and they work their way up to the front of the movie. We already know what's going to happen based on the appointed times.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why when you read and you look at the scriptures, we know that during Sukkot, guess what? Your boy Pharaoh changed his mind. But why? Yah hardened his heart. I see why he hardened his heart.
Because, so it can meet up with the times?
Yes! So it can meet up with the time. Because then what happened after he hardened his heart? What happened? The plagues. The plagues came. And many people, you read anything, they're going to tell you the plagues. Most historians are going to say the plagues lasted 6 months. Now, you all do the math. You all help me. 6 months, 5 to 6 months after Sukkot, what did we get?
Nothing.
What feast do we get 5 to 6 months after Sukkot?
Passover.
Passover! Passover. And then they were let go in. The deliverance came during the Feast of the Unleavened.
What?
Duty.
That's when Pharaoh decided, okay, I can't deal with it. I'm going to let his people go. Their deliverance came during the Feast of the Unleavened. That's why Lot's deliverance from Sodom came when? During the Feast of the Unleavened. I proved to you there was evening, and he also made bread without yeast. So the Most High have always, whether they were written or not, the Most High have always dealt with his servants. He spoke to them. That's why the scripture says, in the spirit of man, is the candle of the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
If the Most High speaks, he spoke through precepts. He spoke through the spirit of Abraham. He spoke to the spirit of Lot. Spoke to the spirit of those who preceded the written law. The written commands. Command has always been around. If we follow the feasts, and the Moeds, Edims, the Moeds, folks, this is gonna make a lot of sense. We know when he's gonna return. We know the season is gonna return, not the day or the hour, but we know the season in which he's going to return. We have put our finger to the pulse of the Most High. We have understood the times and we know what we should do. They are appointed time. That's why they are a shadow of things to come. A shadow is not only what was, but what is and what is to come. Sometimes you precede your shadow, sometimes your shadow precede you. It is a shadow of things to come.
Hallelujah.
So people mock Hebrews and it's 400 years. 400 years, it didn't happen with y'all. It happened, y'all. I'm telling you, it's synonymous. Although we know the plague to Revelation is not here. The Most High deals in what we call allegory. So there is one thing can happen, but it has five or six different meanings. He accomplished it. The old adage, we can kill two birds with one stone. Most High take one event and it accomplishes 5 to 15 different things simultaneously. Folks, if we begin to look at the Most High and study now his acts, see many of you, even we learn in various religious circles like Christianity, his acts, he's a mighty, mighty good God. Oh, he gonna bless you real good. Oh yeah, and that's why you see many Christians now, oh, this too gonna pass. The best is yet to come. Because they're only looking for the actions of the Most High. They're only looking for him to do something for them, but they're not looking at his ways. That's why he made his ways known to Moses, put his acts unto the people. People didn't want to know his ways. They wanted his acts. But Moses understood the ways. How do you understand the ways of the Most High? You follow his appointed times. If you don't follow the feasts of the Most High, the Moeds of the Most High, that's why it's Moed, or we call it a holy convocation. Holy convocation is Kodesh Mikra. Mikra means a rehearsal. So we are practicing for some future public event. That's what it is. So I'm telling you, this Passover is going to be extraordinary. It's going to be something special about this. Our redemption draweth nigh. Our redemption, our deliverance is on its way, Israel. You've been mocked, you've been teased. People think you are crazy. People think it's replacement theology. People are what we call supersessionism. People are saying we're trying to take the place of the poor European Ashkenazi Jews. And these black people are just trying to get an identity by any means necessary. It's derisive theology. It's race baiting, racial superiority. They're trying to steal somebody else's identity. Y'all ain't the real Hebrews of the scripture. And they mocking you these 400 years. I remember at the end of last year, people mocking. Ah, these Hebrews talking about their 400 years. I'm telling you, it's a dangerous thing to fall into the hands of an angry Yahuwah, of an angry God. Because when it comes to his people, I'll bring that out next week too, he is upset and he is zealous and he watch over his people.
Yes.
He said, I love thee with an everlasting love.
Hallelujah.
I'll punish you and I'm going to punish you severely. But do know, I will not let you be utterly destroyed. That was a promise from the Most High. You will not be utterly destroyed because he made a covenant with Abraham and said that you're going to have innumerous seed that's beyond the sand of the sea and the stars of the sky. We don't die, we multiply. Abraham kids, right? So hallelujah, folks. And we'll draw that connection. And then we're also going to show you very clearly in scriptures how the scripture says how the people were lawless because they had no king. And I'm going to tie that in because that's in Revelation as well. The people were lawless because they had no king.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about when, listen, if you ain't following the laws, you ain't got no king coming. Many were saying that day, Lord, Lord, have I done this in your name? Haven't I done that in your name? Haven't I wrought miracles in your name? Haven't I cast out devils in your name? But depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I know you not. 1 John chapter 2, verse 4. If any man say he know y'all, know me, and keep not my commandments, he is a liar. I don't know you if you don't keep my commandments. So that's why, folks, if you do not, if you're lawless, you don't have a king.
I have my hand raised.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm a little challenged.
You had to go through it. You had to go through it. Revelation 16, verse 12. You said that it was a seal, but isn't it a vial is a bowl?
Verse 16? Yeah. So let me show you this. So yes, it's 16. Yes, it's not a seal. So right. We find that, let me go in chronological order for everyone. So we see the seals, which I liken it to the signs of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And open. And so I believe that many of them were open.
Yes.
Before when the Mashiach went into the Shamahim, into the heavens. And then we see, of course, we see the fifth one of things is speaking future, in the future, futuristically. So we see the seals, and then it's not until we get to the seventh seal we find the trumpets begin to blow. That's the seven trumpets, or then we get the seven trumpets. So that's kind of things that happen. The first five are stuff that happened on the earth, right? Where a third of a sea being turned into blood, a third of the inhabitants of the sea being destroyed, or creatures of the sea being destroyed, a third of the ship being destroyed, earthquakes, water turning to blood, so on and so forth. But it's not until we get into what? The sixth one that it says, the seventh trumpet. Whoa. That's what we have, what we call the bowls.
Right.
That's when things happen. And you're right. That would be Revelation chapter 16.
But that's also part of the Euphrates rivers have dried up. You barely can scoop it up with a bucket of water.
That's right.
You better get a bucket of water up out of there. And also in verse 13, and I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of a dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet.
Yes.
Now you had they so-called magician, they false prophet, David Bland was going around the world. He went to President Obama, President Bush, he went to the Pope, he went to Israel, and he was doing that performance of the mouth, frogs coming up out of his mouth.
Right.
Back to 4 to 5 years ago, he was doing it, and they was inviting him all across the world. So when they said the kings, that means kings could be the president, the
Rulers, that's right.
Yes. So.
Yep, you're right. You remember we were talking about the executive orders last night. And mm-hmm. All of the executive orders give, Congress even can't stop executive orders. Once they go into motion, it takes 6 months for a Congress to even to investigate anything of the that falls within the guidelines of any executive order. So that means that the president can do whatever. If he's just a pawn, he can give his power. He's really at the behest of some greater power. All the rulers are going to get. So remember the video we showed. Let me show you all. Just to show you really quickly, for those who did not see it, I want to show you something.
Shalom Aleichem, everybody.
Let me show you this really quickly. Here's an Ashkenazi Jew who said that the anti-Mashiach, or whom they call the Mashiach, is here, and the scripture warns us, right, in Luke chapter 21, Matthew chapter 24, that many prophets will go out in my name, show this really quickly.
I'm making this video today based off an article I just read where Rabbi Zishultz, a top rabbi in Israel, has said that that there have been multiple top rabbis who are in communication with the Mashiach himself, and that things are going to start to develop very, very quickly, and that they want to alert and to inform everyone and update them on what's really going on right now. That the Mashiach himself is here. He's just waiting for the people to really be able to merit his coming, and he doesn't have enough power yet because, as we know, the king gets power from the nation. The Mashiach is connected to every single one of us, and when we do our job, we give life to the Mashiach.
The king gets power from the nation. Connect
him more to Hashem, and he connects us to Hashem, and then we can the redemption can be revealed. And this article is very, very powerful. I'm going to put it in the description, but it's talking about how multiple sources are speaking about how the Mashiach is here, and that things are going to, when things start to reveal, it's going to happen very quickly. It's going to be overwhelming. So they're starting, this has been kept a secret for many years, but now they've been authorized to release this information. Everyone should know that the Mashiach is about to come, and that everyone should be sharing this video and the article that I put. I do not know all the details. I'm like you guys, I have read this article multiple times, and I'm giving my take on what I understood from it. So if you have more information about this, I suggest you comment below. But what I saw was they brought multiple rabbis. Rav Kook said that when the Kinneret fills up, that is a sign that the Mashiach is here. What have we seen? We've seen record amounts of rain this year. The Kinneret is almost completely full. We haven't seen this in so long. This is a great indication that Mashiach is here. And we are seeing crazy things unfold. Also, Rabbi David Abu Atzera stated that the Baba Sali came to him in a dream and said, the Mashiach is offended that he didn't stand when he greeted you. So now he stands whenever he meets people. That the Baba Sali confirmed to him that he met the Mashiach. And he's here in Israel. Also, Rav Chaim Kanievsky would previously state that the Mashiach is coming through the door. Then he said the Mashiach is here. And now he said to his donors, every year he sends out donors, he collects from America for the yeshivas. He said, do not leave. The Mashiach is too close. You have to stay here in Israel. We are seeing multiple signs of the Mashiach's coming. And that they're saying that when things start to gain momentum, things are going to happen very quickly. And things are that we've never seen before. That I'm not going to go too much into detail, but revelations are going to be revealed, and that the great leaders have authorized this information to be released to get people ready, because they don't want it to be completely a shock. So now they're starting to release the information on this. So Bezrat Hashem will be soon. And what we have to do, because it doesn't mean that things are guaranteed, even though we're getting all these signs from Mashiach here, we have to do even more, because always right before redemption, there's tests, there's challenges. Right before the light, there's always the darkest dark before the light. So we have to bring light to the situation. We have to do a little bit more. We have to encourage others in this situation, do more mitzvot, and that will speed up the process of Mashiach. It will gain momentum. And,
So notice he said it's going to speed up the process of the Mashiach coming, or the Mashiach being revealed. In that he's offended when people are in his presence and they do not stand. And notice he said where the Mashiach, as he called it, or the Mashiach, where he gets his power. That he gets power from the nations. Do you know, you ever read a scripture of Yahusha, the Mashiach getting his power from the nations?
Never.
Never. But see, that's how you know it's the false Antichrist. That's how you know that it is the anti-Mashiach. Because that's what happened. Executive orders are put in place. So when you have all type of chaos like now, like this year, and you're now in a police state, the power can now be given to who? It can be given to the Antichrist. Now he makes all the rules for the nations. And he's going to rule 3.5 years according to the scriptures. So Thanks for bringing it out, Tanisha. All right, anyone else? There's still quite a few of you on here. Any questions?
Dr. Howard, you use certain translations of the Bible and what have you. I know the King James has some issues and what have you, but as well as all of them do. But can that be brought up, which translation you're using at the time or something?
Sure, yeah, I sure will. So a lot of times I use, for whenever I'm teaching, I try to use sometimes ESV, English Standard Version.
Right.
I got some problems with it, but I got some problems also with King James Version as well.
Sure.
They both. So, but for teaching purposes, for student people are at different levels, I try to use ESV for teaching purposes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Because it helps in terms of, it helps with the continuity of thought, ESV.
So yeah. They consider it as the most accurate of the ABSB.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they all got issues. They all
right.
Their Eurocentric translation. And so whenever anything is Eurocentric, it tend to dilute the Hebrewism of it and the original intent. And so I got a problem with even King James or KJV onlyus. They only use the KJV, and as a result, I think they do themselves a great disservice. In fact, in my class, I mean, on Wednesday nights, my defending the law class, we are specifically dealing with how to defend the law, and we find a number, quite a bit of words that have been mistranslated.
Right, right.
And so it makes for a poor understanding of the scriptures. So it takes work, folks. It takes some diving into, again, inductive study is what we call it, inductive study. So you have any premises, but you want to make sure that it adds up to the conclusion. Like we find a number of scriptures that they tend to contradict themselves. So if you read Romans chapter 3, verse 20, you'll find in the first part of the scripture is speaking against the law, but the second part of the same scripture is for the law. So whenever you see scriptures like that, it should raise some red flags. You say, okay, something is wrong with it. Same thing with Galatians chapter 3, verse 10. It should raise some red flags. Wait a minute. The first part of it contradicts the second part of the same scripture. So that's when you need to do some investigation, what I call jurisprudence of line upon line, precept upon precept. You really need to investigate as to why. So I use Hallelujah Scriptures, but Hallelujah Scriptures is probably more accurate in terms of Hebrewism, but I don't like using it necessarily to teach. For quoting purposes, it's great. But for teaching purposes, I try to embrace what we call colloquialism, so that people can understand. I try to be colloquial to help for the understanding of the people.
Right.
So King James is very common among people, but you look at NASB or ESV in terms of teaching purposes, those tend to be, at least in my guesstimation, they tend to be better serve the learner or the recipient of the scriptures.
It just gives me a better way of understanding when I go back and look through scripture of the lesson and whatever, what version it came out of, so I could compare it and see what's going on, compare it with other scriptures and whatever as
right.
well.
Right.
To just know, you know, where it's coming from.
Right. All right. Well, I see a lot of people got off. There's still 20 of you all here, 5, 10, 15, still 20 of you all still on. Any more questions that we need to address?
Yes. What do you think about what's going on right now at this moment of time?
Where do we begin? We've been talking about that. I tell you what, me and you will have a conversation about that. But what's going on is a number of things. I do believe that this is a sign of the time. We know there must be a major earthquake before the plagues begin. So you stop listening to those Christians. Oh, Jesus is coming back. Like you said, he would. Folks, we know that redemption draw 9, and the scripture says, as we just read, it is still to come. It's still to come. We just know we're getting ready. We're in that season. We know that it's getting close. That's why it's called end times. But this is really displaying the evenness of man's heart. Personally, we have been talking about the 5G, and that radiation is, they say that it's
killing.
Yeah, but the radiation from 4G to 5G is not even close. It's the radiation is at dangerous levels. Yeah. And so a lot of things I won't say on this platform, but we have some private platforms that we've been sharing.
That is a dangerous time. You know, y'all been speaking to me, and he was telling me our people have to turn down our plates. The things that we listen to, the things that we eat, the things that we is doing right now in this day and time. And I remember 2 years ago when we first started, when y'all came to me, he told me, he says, my people don't change their ways. They was dying off quickly. Right. And the time has came. And the time is going to keep coming. It's going to get worse than before it get better. Mm-hmm. And I was talking to some people on today, some Christianity, some other religion groups, Islam. And they said, this is the judgment day. I said, this ain't the judgment day. This due upon man's sins. Our sinful ways will bring disaster to the earth. And when you talk about the earthquake is coming. The earthquake gonna be among the people of the ones who sin against Yah on word and who's not in alignment with his word. And he been dealing with me because my heart cries out for our people, all nations of people, because we are dying quickly. And this disease is nothing right now, but when it really get to the depth, like you said, people is selling their stocks, people is doing a lot of things because it's going to be one man try to rule over everything. So at the moment of time, we need to be in prayer. We need to pray for each other. We need to come together as colored people. I do not use the nationality of black because that's a title that they have on label over our heads, because the Bible never speaks about blacks. The Bible speaks of color. So this is a serious time. Even on the last week before I have got sick, and I know I had been out the laws of the Most High, and the Most High has showed me on last week because I was so sick I couldn't move. I thought I was dying because things that I had went back to. So in saying a lot, my body healed quick. I didn't go back to everything that I used to do, but my eating habits. You know, I started eating wrong. I started doing things wrong. And it was like three weeks ago, I told everybody, I said, man, stop eating meat. Stop eating meat. Stop eating meat. And what they're doing is it's in our food. And whatever we eating, it might be in the water. We never know where it's coming from. But I was watching an interview and I was showing my wife. I said, you see, he hesitated to say something. Then he went to another topic. He switched it up. So it is in our food. That's why the people is dying quickly. It's moving quickly, quickly, quickly. And it ain't going to stop. So, man, this lesson, what you is teaching right now, is doing with the day and time and hour right now. So, you know, if people don't take heed to this, they would start dropping just like that quickly. And man, y'all is an awesome father. It's a difference between a father and a daddy. A daddy just appear in your life time to time, but a father who cares about you, lays down the law and give you the right thing for you sustain. Right. So this lesson was a good lesson on today and more to come. Hopefully, as Hebrews, as colored people, we humble ourselves and turn from their wicked ways. I'm talking about other nation ways.
Yeah.
When they say from wicked ways, they're talking about other nation ways. That's why we it's in the predicament that we are in now. I'm talking about the hairstyles, the clothing, and everything else. You know, I had to do some work myself because of the things I have did. We all are part of the equation, so we all got to work together as people.
That's right.
This was good.
Yeah, let me read this, because you brought up something. Hosea chapter 10. I read this the other day, and let me show you all something really quickly. All right, then we'll let everyone go. Hosea chapter 10, verse 7, it says, "And Samaria and its king will float away like the twig of the surface of the waters." Now, I make a lot of references dealing with the northern kingdom. And so when you really understand the historical context of and do historical criticism, particularly of Hosea, you know he's talking about the northern kingdom, right? The northern kingdom, verse 8. "And the high places of the wicked will be destroyed. And it is the sin of Israel." Let me say this again. The high places of wickedness will be destroyed. "It is the sin of Israel. Thorn and thistles will grow up and cover their altars. Then they will say to the mountain, cover us." It's talking about Israel. It's not talking about any other nations. Watch this. "Cover us, and the hills fall on us." Verse 9. "Since the days of Gibeah, you have sinned, O Israel, and there you have remained in your sin. Did not war overtake the evildoers of Gibeah?" Now, Gibeah lived way before then. So this was not written in the days of Gibeah, but it's making reference to it. Watch this, verse 10. "When I please, I will punish them. Nations will be gathered against them to put them in the bonds for their double sins." For their double sin. I want you to look at this here, because although it's talking about the northern kingdom, it's talking about our people. It's talking about the dispersed of Israel. We are dispersed now. Let me look at this prophetic scripture here, because it says against the nations because of what? Their rebellion. That the law is being revealed. The law is being revealed to his people once again, is what Hosea is saying. The law is being revealed to you again, Israel. It's being shown to you once again, but the people keep rejecting it. They are not accepting it over again. And that's why our people are in Christianity. We have this love affair with paganism. And again, we are rejecting, as Hosea said here, we're rejecting the law again. Notice it says double sin. So he said, "I'm going to punish you for double sin." It's because not only the sin that you occur, but when you reject Torah, you reject my laws, I'm going to punish you for the double sin that has come upon you. And so that's why Hosea 3:4 says, "And for the Israelites will live many days without a king or prince, without sacrifice or sacred stones, without the ephod or idol. Afterwards, the Israelites will return and seek Yahuwah their Elohim and David the king, and they will be trembling to Yahuwah and to his blessings in the last days." So that's why I prophesy about about the kings of the day. And then it goes back and talk about the days of Gibeah. Of Gibeah were long before any king was established. And the Most High said, "I'm going to punish you, but I'm going to punish you because of your double sin." It's specifically talking about Israel. Now, you can fact check me or whatever, but our people our people is going to, we're going to go through a severe. You go to Romans chapter 2, judgment. It says, Yah is no respected person. But it says, for those who, is for you to know to do and not to do, to you it is sin. That's why it says, for when you read Romans chapter 2, it says, for those who hear the law, you ain't gonna be justified, but only doers of the law. And in so many words, individuals who, there are some people who don't know the law, you're gonna be judged accordingly. But for those who know the law and you didn't do the law, you're gonna be judged more severely. So that's why in Hosea here, he's saying the double sin of Israel. It's our stiff-necked people who's married to this religious illusion of Christianity. And they won't come out. And that's why Hosea says it's going to be double sin upon you.
That's why I like that word adultery. Adultery is a big word. Adultery is you. Adultery means to not be adultery towards human life, but adultery towards the word. Mm-hmm. It basically was pointed towards the word. If you are adultery towards the word, of course you're going to be adultery towards human life. That's automatic. Man, it just, I'm just ecstatical about what's happening right now, because everything that is happening, I got it written down in my diary, and it's coming to pass quickly and swiftly. Like we had a talk before. He said, everybody ain't going to come out of captivity, and that is so true. And captivity don't mean death. You could be suffering in captivity at the same time, being tortured. And what happened is this very thing had backfired on the evil one. So they can't believe that it is happening the way it is. And like you said, it's going to be nations coming up against nations. And That's basically what we're facing right now. So, you know, I don't want to talk no more further. You know what I'm saying? So it's very important that we follow the laws of the Most High as colored people.
That's right.
And if we don't do that, we ignore the sign, we will be doomed just like the other nations.
That's right. You're right. Shanika, is it Shanika? You had your hand raised? Shanika? Okay. Let me read some of you all chats here. Yes, I'm sorry.
Oh, I was saying, Dr. Howard, that now again, when it says nation against nation, do you think it's a possibility that it may be talking about like similar to how, you know, the Union and the Confederacy, like the nation is rising up against.
You hit it on the nail. Absolutely. I'm going to bring that up next week. Absolutely. Because it's nation.
Oh, okay.
Nation instead of kingdom against, or nations, the nation versus nation, instead of nations against nations. So know this is very specific when it comes to that. When you understand Greek language, you got to be very careful in terms of what and what form that is written in. All right, what is the mode? What is the mood rather of the language? And so, yes, it's talking about nation singular, not nation plural.
Right, and lastly. I'm just curious. We having Shabbat this Saturday.
So we will talk about that off the. We will talk about that. Yes, sir.
Okay. Apologies. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, we'll put it back in our form thing. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Maybe one or two more questions, and we're going to wish you all a lot later. Talk. Mighty quiet tonight. Still about 20 of you all on, and it's quiet. All right. Well, with that in mind,
I have it muted out so I can hear.
That's fine. Is it Shelly?
Yeah.
Shalom.
Chilo.
Yeah, you have a question or comment?
No, I was saying, you saying it was quiet. I said I had took my muted myself out so I wouldn't, you know, wouldn't be no disturbance. No,
I was referencing quiet as in no one is having questions or comments.
Oh, it's just a lot to take in, and yeah. It's a lot that you have to think about and meditate on and pray on.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. That's why we need a platform.
It was a very good teaching. So yes, I'm listening.
Right. I think we need a platform where I can see you all too. We can raise hands, we can ask questions. It just doesn't make for the best setting when we're doing it on this platform. Things get all out of sequence, and you can't hear people, and there's a number of impediments going on simultaneously. And so sometimes this platform isn't the best for doing Bible studies in terms of interactive Bible studies. All right.
Yeah.
Also, I'm sorry, Doc. Also, concerning the, I'm sorry, did I cut someone off?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Also concerning the 5G deal, I've been seeing in my neighborhood. I actually took pictures. I'm gonna share it on the group text of a huge DTE truck. It looks like the double bus that's connected by the little middle spring, but it was a DTE truck, and it was over by a school. So I'm going to share that picture as well. But I also watched the video that you send, and I was keeping my eye open for that because I live around the school. So
yeah, they're in the schools now as well. So they're putting that while schools are out, they're putting all the technology in the schools now. And so yeah, absolutely.
So that being said, like say if that 5G that they're putting in schools, and like and a lot of people may be if they know or aware, a lot of the people that's aware would be a little reluctant to send their children to school knowing that this technology is there, but then we'll face problems with society and things of the sort, legal things.
For the awakened believer, you better listen to the Ruach. Number one, you need to listen to the Ruach. He that have an ear, let him hear what the Ruach is saying. You got to be guided and led by the Ruach. If you don't have a Ruach in this time, it is spiritual euthanasia. You got to have the Ruach in this time, and you better have someone whom you can, you know, when I hear all these Israelites, you don't need no assembly. You don't need to, number one, that we have never operated that way. We have always been a tribal people. We've always been a communal people. Rather, we look in the Torah, the assembly in the desert, or rather we have Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 3, Acts chapter 4. We have always been a communal people. And for those who are alone, it's going to be very, very difficult. So you better be in a community where you're like-minded believers, and you better listen to the Ruach in order to survive. It's going to take unprecedented wisdom in this hour. It's going to take wisdom to survive the signs of the times. Now, we didn't get to it tonight, but... The scripture talks about the barren woman during these times. Why do the Mashiach praise the barren woman? Because she ain't got no kids to look after during this, because it's going to be difficult to travel, to hide, to go places, to do things, to for survival purposes. So that's why the Mashiach praised the barren woman during this time, because she ain't got any kids. She don't have children to look after. You got children? And that's why even he talks about the woman who's pregnant. You say, wow, when it's time, it's going to be difficult for you. When you're pregnant or you got small children.
Yeah, woe unto them that have sucklings.
That's right. All right. I think, Shanika, did you have your hand up? Okay. All right, well, I know that it's maybe about 18 of you all are now. Many people got off, but all praises to the Most High. to the...
I just want, could I touch on the school issue?
Yes, Karen, yes.
So, I mean, you know, everything is in a time and in a space. So for the time that, say, DeLeon is concerned about, like, you know, I don't want to send my kids back knowing X, Y, and Z. My son is homeschooled through a cyber academy, and they send him everything. They send him a computer. They send him science supplies. So, like, you know, a little Petri dish thing. It wasn't nothing in it, but I'm not even the Petri dish. What's the tall one called? I forget. But anyway, they send him, you know, his core books. So his science, his math book, a language arts book, and everything is done online. They do meet with kind of like what we're doing right now with the teacher of certain classes twice a week. His homeroom teacher, if he wants to, once a week. For me, right now, that works. I mean, he's been in it. This is his second year. He's doing all right. His grade fluctuates. It's kind of like he's 14, okay? So anyway, I'm happy with it. And the reason that I went that way originally was because I was just tired of the, you know, like, you're not going to force Christmas on me, period. Okay, so I didn't, and you're not going to force the, you know, the science on me and mine either. So I chose to bring him out of the regular school because I didn't want him further. And not saying that they don't, you know, talk about the spinning of the earth and all of that. They do, but I'm able to monitor that because he's with me. He's right here. I can say, well, you know, that's not true and so on and so forth. So my point is just that you can still get a waiver for the shots. I still had to get a waiver for the shots, and I still had to, you know, send his birth certificate and all that stuff. But he's here. He's homeschooled. If I have to take him out with me, the computer is hotspotted, and we can still go wherever we want to go, and he's still in school. So I understand that that's only going to last for a while, but if that's your concern and you can keep your children at home, there is another way. That's all I want to say.
Absolutely. So we are currently working on that, too. I know a lot of believers are homeschooling. In fact, there's an increase on the so-called African-American parents. They are opting to homeschool their children. So even myself, in terms of being a college professor, I have what we call a unique epistemological approach that shape what we call andragogical and pedagogical learning styles. So what my students, and this is over the course of three different institutions of higher learning, instead of making the student adapt to my teaching style, I adapt to their learning style. So it is not what we call frontal teaching as much as it is collaborative learning. So that works for the so-called African-American child, if always. Rather, you know, we have been in the system for quite some time, since the late 1800s. Beginning of the 1900s. And so from the 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s and even the 80s and 90s and the 2000s, this system doesn't work for our children. It's not our, we are not a Greek people. We are not a Tectonic or Germanic language people. We are more experiential. We are more what we call practicing the activus of the activity. We are more an active people. Hebrew is a lot active language. You all heard me say all the time that language is not just a tool for communication, but it's a vehicle for culture. So if you remove the language, then you eradicate the culture. So we got to make sure that homeschooling is best for us. So that's why we started the Lion's Whelp. And so Lion's Whelp, which is the Hebrew Academy for Children, only come along the side of parents to assist parents in their curriculum. So we will be unveiling that soon. And it just give Israelite parents, Hebrew parents all over, give them an opportunity for their children to be in a setting where they can just turn on their computers and we can teach them their history, teach them the laws, teach them how to write Hebrew and understand Hebrew, teach their history beyond 1619, et cetera. teach them about the Mashiach, the importance of salvation, the importance of the gospel, the importance of the Great Commission. All those things are very important. So we really come alongside of the parents to do it. So Karen, I want to talk to you about that as well. I want you to join our this task force or this committee that specifically deal with that. But great question, Dillion. I think there should be some phobias about sending your children back to a public school system. And Shanika, I see your comment. I see your comment. You are you have a hard time. I think there might be a audio button on there, but if not, if you maybe can inbox me if you cannot get on. Do you see an audio button where you can click audio?
I know while she found that button, I just wanted to make a comment. Yes, thank you again, Karen, because I have something I have been doing with my 9-month-old child and my newborn. They have not been getting shots, and I do have, well, my newborn isn't here yet, but my 9-month-old, I do have waivers for him. He has not received any immunizations at all, and I got the waiver for him if he were to even attend daycare or anything of the sort. And with him and my newborn, I wouldn't have a problem with homeschooling them with you know, with even through the community or when we can, me and my wife at the time, when we can do it. But the my other two children is where I'm like a little, call it roles, because this, it's not just my, you know, input on that. It's more of like, okay, I want to homeschool them, but the opposite wants to send them to school. And then I'm like, okay, I'm a little, my hands is a bit tied there. So I'm going through, you know, processes now to try to fix that. But
yeah, we're dealing with a various issue. And so we're going to be able to, in the next couple of weeks or so, be able to provide not only some alternatives for many of you, and this in general, all over the country, all over internationally. But we know that's going to be for a conference in July. That's going to be one of the major workshops we're having, is dealing with that issue, homeschooling, and what are the rights? What are your rights concerning that? What do you need to prepare one? How do you join a cohort or a coalition? So all those things are issues that I think in the next couple of weeks or so, we're going to have some viable options for those who are seeking it. Yeah. Well, it's Kwame Yasharela. It's time to rise up, Israel. To rise up, we do not fight for victory, we fight in victory. So, yeah, I'm sorry, Shanika. Why don't you inbox me, or if you want to type it, I can. I'll respond if you want me to respond to it publicly. If not, if you inbox me, I can address your question.
I'm not sure if she can come on.
Are you typing, Shanika? Okay. While she's doing that, anyone else have a comment? The hour is late now.
Dr. Howard, this is Eliyahu. Could you give me a call when you get a minute about a building?
Yes, I sure will. All right. Tora.
I was just going to say her computer may be like mine, and she probably is going to have to call in and use another little ID.
Right.
Because I talk and listen through my phone.
Right. Yeah, it's probably have to do the same there. All right. She says she's trying to ask a question, but she's not sure how to work the audio. Absolutely. So we'll assist her in terms of that another time. Well, Ms. Baha, stay safe. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. We will say of Yahuwah, he is our refuge is our fortress. He is our Elohim, and him shall we trust. Surely he shall deliver us from the snare of the following, from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover us with his feathers. Under his wings shall we trust. He shall deliver us from the arrow that fly by day, the destruction of wasted at noonday. 1,000 will fall at our sides and 1,000 at our right hand, but it will not come nigh our dwelling. And so we pray that the Most High will protect you and keep you and watch over you, that he will bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you, lift up his countenance towards you, and grant you peace in the name of Yahusha, Yahusha.
Hey, BK.
Yes.
Hey, someone had a question. Do you have any advice for the pregnant women during these times?
We do. We do. We do have some. We'll talk about that off air. We devised a plan for that, as many of you all know, but I do. But just in short, community, you're going to need help. You're going to need community. Much like they did in Acts 2 and Acts chapter 3, there was no need among them because we all pitched in. So you're going to need people around you who are like-minded, who have you and your child or soon-to-be child best interests at heart. So you're going to need to be in a community of people, of like-minded, loving people, full of the Ruach.
So that question was from Janai or Janae?
Janae or Janai. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my wife.
Okay, right. Hallelujah.
All right.
All right. All right. Well, shalom, shalom. Love you, Mishpahat. And we will talk soon. Most of us talk 5-6 times a day anyways. But shalom, shalom.
Hello.
Shalom.
Leo Tov.
Shalom.
Shalom, shalom.
Shalom, shalom.